I know most of you, and I think I've introduced myself. She's just going to bring you a copy.
We can have a pen.
You're going to have to take notes, maybe. Some of you know me, some of you don't. I'm Lisa Ingleby from Spanish Peaks Regional Outreach Clinic. And right now, currently, I'm working as a voice care bedtime coordinator. And we're going to incorporate a little bit of what I do into the presentation today. But I want to thank you all for coming. I've been in the geriatric field most of my life. Started very young, taking care of aunts, grandparents, family members, etc. And so the caretaking started for me very, very young. And so my experiences have just brought me back to this point again where I keep going back to seniors and keep going back to seniors. And I have a little bit of fitness education in there and a little bit of fitness background. I have several of my clients that used to come with me to my senior fitness class. And several people that are currently attending the current senior fitness class held by Washington Underground in Walsenburg. So I'm glad to see all of your happy faces here today. So we're going to go through just talking about a little bit of the golden years, whether this is for yourself, for family members, for whomever, just an education. And the golden years necessarily, you know, when we plan and anticipate what may happen in our later years, it's really never truly what we expect. Presentation is going to guide you through choices so it can be a smooth transition for you and your family. So this isn't quite the smooth transition I would expect. And I have to brave it up for all those people that live in New York City and want to live like this. It would drive me absolutely nuts. And would hope that all of those people and all of that transition going from day to day to day to day. And you know, I think the advantage of living in a large metropolis like New York City or Chicago or LA is that sometimes these communities have everything right there for them in a little small community where they can get their needs met medically or they're necessarily getting some groceries or transportation needs met very easily. Here in rural America, it is a little bit tougher and just find that those transmissions could be different for everybody who wants to live like that. I recently attended a Strategic on Aging Planning Committee in Pueblo, and the state of Colorado was doing just a little bit of research because they know that we're going to hit a huge tsunami of geriatrics coming up. And the number of Coloradans age 65 and over projected to rise more than 508,000 by 2030. And that's a 68 increase from today. And so we're beyond even the baby boomers who are still baby booming and growing older. So, I mean, that tsunami is coming. The life expectancy in 1900 today increased 70% from 50 to 80. So life is changing and people are living longer. They want to age in place. They want to stay in their homes. And sometimes that's not real. And so today we're going to talk about how this transition, you're going to take people from living independently at home to the end of life. So it is a lot of information. Please feel free to stop me if you have a question while I'm presenting at that slide or write it down on your notes so that we can ask. I will have a time at the end for questions, okay? So what is that going to look like? Oops, wrong one. Would I press it again?
I don't know what you did.
Oh, there you go. Oh, sorry. So, first we're going to talk a little bit about coping skills as we age, because people do want to remain independent and stay at home. And so this is just a little advice from experience all of my years, but really the secret is exercise and moving. And I love that commercial, whatever drug commercial it is, the body that stays in motion, and it's very, very true. You have to stay in motion. You have to eat that healthy diet that's prescribed by your doctor. Keep the weight off and try to stay away from those diseases that will eventually take your life. Stay on your prescribed medications. Stay mentally challenged. A lot of people just don't look at this because we have so much social interaction and then we stop as we tend to stay home alone and we're not really getting that social interaction. That's very, very, very important. I know some of you have seen the research on Alzheimer's and how important it is to stay socially active and to communicate with friends and calling people and talking to people, having coffee, all of those things. So you need that support network of others. And you need to be a social butterfly. I know some people, and I notice this tendency in myself as I'm getting older, I just want to stay home.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking to myself, I really need to get out more, you know, socially, and I don't. And a lot, acceptance and honesty goes a long way. I think what I run into most when I'm visiting with my seniors is that bump in the road where they just can't accept that they're getting older, and it's really hard. And so, you know, I never really understood when I was taking care of my grandmother why she kept telling everybody she was 39. And she did not want people to know her true age. And I took this woman to Europe when she was 92. And I'm thinking, you know, she was young, and she didn't see any barriers or any factors in anything stopping her from doing anything she wanted at any age. And she died a very healthy life at 98. And I think it is your attitude, and it's being honest with yourself, and it's being, I think, just real about where it is.
Oh, I'm sorry.
There's no fear of pride or embarrassment in communicating changes in your family. That's a big thing. Visiting with somebody recently who whose mother is very proud and does not want to admit that she is getting older and doesn't want to admit that she needs help and family members are going to have to move in. And doesn't want to let go of stuff, or doesn't want to admit, and so embarrassed because she's like, oh, dang it, now I have to admit that I need help. And that's hard. That's really hard for people. So be prepared for the inevitable is coming, whether we like it or not, right? Mm-hmm. So these are some things that you're going to see, signs and symptoms. This slide is primarily geared towards the children of aging parents. And you're going to see a loss of memory, maybe a loss of appetite. They're not really regularly eating their meals like they should, or be preparing their meals like they should, or they're eating a lot of TV dinners, or they're eating a lot of snacky crackers and pastries and things that really aren't good meals. So you have to be careful that you want to make sure they're eating correctly. They're starting to lose their senses. I think all of us as we age know that we're going to possibly get those lovely diseases that are going to affect our eyes and our ears and our hearing and our taste and all that fun stuff. The inability to cognitively make those sound decisions, saying that they can still drive, and maybe they shouldn't. Maybe there's some safety issues going on and they shouldn't be driving. They're becoming a little more frail. They're becoming weak. Maybe they've had a few hospitalizations because of some illnesses. Maybe they're starting to need some oxygen. And they're starting to lose balance because their reflexes are deteriorating and they're falling. You know, that could be one of the things. Loss of urinary bowel control. And be safe in general public situations. Maybe they're confused. I sadly have a brother-in-law, my sister passed. Her husband developed Alzheimer's very, very young. And they discovered it when he was just touring DC while his new wife was out doing a performance. They're both actors, and she was doing a performance, and he was just walking around DC, and he couldn't find the hotel to get back home. And they were really scared because they couldn't find him in this large city. And so they finally diagnosed him with Alzheimer's. And you know, you have to consider that those public situations can be an indicator. Maybe they're not interested in getting out. They've lost a spouse. They're starting to not be able to perform their daily living activities, like taking their bath, and they're starting to not wear new clothes, and they're wearing the same worn-out clothes. Maybe they can't manage their medication. They're starting to forget to take meds regularly and on time. And what happens with this is that you're going to get those increased signs of disease, like high blood pressure or diabetes or heart attack or a stroke. And so maybe they have been recently diagnosed. And these are the really top four killers, and we really do need to pay attention to that. And maybe they have the inability to manage money. They're not paying their bills on time. You notice that some mail is stacking up, and they're starting to hoard more, and it's becoming more and more and more and more, and pretty soon they're not throwing anything out. And then there could be some emotional signs of depression or distress due to all of the above, because that's all really stressful, because we really all don't like those things, you know? So everybody wants to stay in their home sweet home, and everybody really wants to be able to age in place, like those statistics for Colorado have shown, but sometimes that's not realistic. And so I'm going to continue to walk you through some next steps. So you want to have some stabilizing options. So these are some things that you need to look forward to, is to really make an appointment, get a doctor's diagnosis. Is there some dementia? having maybe just a mini mental test and having somebody really diagnose can get you to go in the right direction, so you know which direction you need to go in. So one of the first steps would be, let's say this person's really not wanting to leave and they want to stay home. So you want to maybe get some caretaker help. So a lot of the information I'm providing for you today is for local area agencies. I'm supporting them and just wanting to let you know what's out there here currently. So the Council of Governments, Alta Vista, Caring Angels, and People Care in our area provide non-medical services. And they have to qualify for those services. And some do accept private pay, but mainly those people that are on Medicaid can apply for these services and get some in-home care. Home health agencies, if the doctor is recommending after hospitalization or some other care that where they physically need a nurse to come in and check on them, monitor their medication, etc. Currently we have Mountain Home Creek, and usually, like I said, that has to be prescribed by a doctor. They could also get living care and just hire a private caretaker, and they probably would have to pay for that. They could move in with their children or grandchildren or a friend. They could use the personal safety monitoring device. They could have a family or friend or member check on them daily, or they could go to adult daycare services. So all of those are options. It really depends on the level of care they need.
Do we have an adult daycare here?
Not here, we do in Trinidad.
Trinidad.
So this is Freedom on a String. This is what I do. And so I provide the personal monitoring devices. And Becky asked a really good question at the beginning. She said, what do I do if I fall and I've knocked myself out and I can't press the button, I can't get up, what do I do? Well, this is a fall detector and it will call automatically. Okay, so I'm gonna go ahead and make a call for you guys today just so that you can see who's on the other line. They will call you if you don't answer. And this is what's really nice. So you've fallen and you've knocked yourself out. They're going to try to respond to you through this, but let's say you can't talk. And so when you don't answer them, they're going to call your house and or they're going to call. Hi, Vicki. No, this is Elisa. We're just doing a test. Thank you. Have a good day. Okay. Bye-bye, Vicki. So they're going to call me if I don't answer. So they would call my cell phone or my home line right after that. And then if they don't hit me that way, then they're going to go down the call list and they're going to call people that I've listed on their profile to go ahead and decide, okay, we have Lisa, she's on the floor. We don't know what's going on. Our fall detector's gone off. Can you please go over there? Hi, welcome. Please sign in and
does
come
it
on
have
in.
GPS on it also?
Yes, it does. So they know where you are. And so that's really nice.
So if you're out at Lathrop walking around, they know.
Yes, they have an idea of knowing where you are. So that's really good. So that's Freedom on a String for some people. That gives them the ability to stay home a little bit longer. And that does give people the freedom that they want. Where at least children feel a peace of mind. Yesterday, one of my customers said, you know, I was just thinking about canceling, but I think I'm going to keep it just for my peace of mind. And I said, I think you should. Because I said, I think it is important that you understand that if this particular client has dementia and she doesn't always remember to press her button. Thank you guys for coming. And he said, just when I go to Pueblo to get groceries or shop or do errands for her, she'll at least call me. She at least has the understanding to call me and then I tell her, press your button. And then they'll go through everything and at least get an ambulance there for her. Because she did fall the other day. But it just depends, again, on the situation and how independent they really want to stay. So I call that Freedom on a String.
How much is the cost on that?
$35 a month. And, that's the landlines. $45 a month for the mobile and $45 for installation.
That's really reasonable.
It's actually an average price, and for this area, it's very cheap. There are so many personal monitoring agencies out there, and they charge anywhere from $40 to $85.
Who's this connected with?
This, my particular program is voice care. This is connected with the hospital. Hospital started this program 20 years ago out of their emergency room. And it has grown to where we lease and we operate now out of a company called Tunstall in New York. And they supply me with my machines. And after the presentation, I have everything set up if you have more questions about that. So the next thing would be, let's consider some financial options and some things about, okay, where are we financially so we know the choices that we can make. So how is their retirement plan? Did they save? And I'm going to tell you right now, when you see the numbers in the next few slides, I don't think any of us will ever have the amount of money that it needs to save to have that month-to-month income. That's infinity of $1 million. And let's pray God Medicaid is still around to pay for all of us to live in retirement. Then my number one push here is long-term care insurance. If you are still young, get long-term care insurance. When I was the administrator at the Legacy in Trinidad, I had a client who lived in there free for $4,000 a month. Free. 5 years. Free. Free. Because he had long-term care insurance, and it paid for everything. There are certain riders that say you need a nurse or don't need a nurse in assisted living, so you need to make sure that you check the mark that says I don't need a nurse, because most assisted livings don't have nurses. It's too expensive for their staff. They may occasionally get an assisted living where they'll have a nurse come in and check on people and contract out to those nurses, but they don't necessarily have a nurse on staff. And so long-term care insurance, to me, I don't think you're ever too young to start that. I mean, you have to pay, but eventually you will need it. And then I add another patient who, she did have long-term care insurance, and she had that special rider, and they wouldn't pay. They only paid a very small portion of it. So be careful with how you do that, but get it. I mean, investigate it. Find an insurance agent that knows about it. Selling and liquidating your assets. How much is Social Security going to pay? So I mean, these are choices that you're going to have to add up. What's Medicare doing in your supplemental health insurance? And I need people to understand this. I get this question a lot. I think everybody here, I think, knows the difference between Medicare and Medicaid. Yes?
Yes.
Okay, good. So having an AARP supplemental health insurance is going to help with those long-term care costs when Medicare does not pay for everything in hospitalization, and you have to go into a long-term care facility after a hospitalization. So sometimes that supplemental health insurance will help you. So that also is a good plan. But government agencies like Medicaid, let me tell you a little bit about Medicaid. You have to become eligible on a case-by-case basis. The regulations are standard, but they vary. And part of one of the programs, the abbreviation HCBS stands for Healthcare Blind, Home and Care Community Based Services. You have to apply for this certain program and be eligible for it, and if you become eligible for it, then you have the financial eligibility for you to be able to meet that criteria. And so, for instance, I have several people that are on HCBS services who qualify for my monitors, and Medicaid will pay for them, or a med box, and Medicaid will pay for them. Because in Medicaid's mind, it's cheaper to pay for those in-home care services than it is to send them to a long-term care facility. Are you with me? Okay. So say, for instance, down the road, you know that mom and dad don't have enough retirement money, and you know that eventually they may have to rely on social services and Medicaid to pay for their long-term care. There's a five-year eligibility grace period for you to have everything deeded over so that you don't have any of your assets left. So you have to show Medicaid that you have $2,000 or $2,200 left for just yourself. Now, if it's your spouse can still stay home and have assets worth $123,600,000. And they won't come back and put a lien on your home, or they won't try to take anything away. Once they pay for long-term care, they're going to say after you sell the house, well, excuse me, you have a bill to pay. You owe us $500,000. And they can take your assets. So you have to pay attention to exactly, and I recommend that you talk to a lawyer. This is not my specialty, This is just from experience what has happened to some of my clients. And then also there's housing authority, where there's low income or fixed income housing that people can go live and stay in, that you just simply apply for based on your income every month. And if your social security is less than $1,000, they usually can take you. It's just a matter of waiting and a matter of applying. Any questions on any of this?
But it's your total assets, not just your income from social security, right?
I believe so.
Yes.
So let's look at some cost of long-term care and that $1 million that we need. So let's say, for instance, mom does want to stay home, and she wants private care, and she wants to pay for it 24/7. So let's just say minimum, you're going to pay that person $10 an hour. You're going to pay several people that. So I just did some averages for you. So if she wanted 24-hour care, at a minimum, you're going to pay $72.75. Just at $10 an hour for a whole month. And then at $20 an hour, you're going to pay $11,160. So in assisted living, those averages range from $2,000 to $10,000. In the back, I have left a bunch of senior blue books. And this is a really good, valuable resource. Senior Blue Book comes out in our area around this time every year. So this one ended in February of this month, and so they'll be putting out a new one starting next month. And this gives you a huge list of assisted livings, long-term cares, and other agencies that have certain prices. So I averaged, it was about $2,000. There's a few in here that start at 17-something, 17.80. And then they go as high as 10,000. And the reason they go on 10,000 is based on their amenities, and some facilities don't accept insurance or Medicaid. But the daily living skills vary according to facility, and this is what you need to understand if you're choosing an assisted living. And I would love it if Jean would want to chime in here what they're going to do at the Levita Village. But some assisted livings have a price, like the Legacies that I worked for. We were an all-inclusive facility. So prices started out at $2,150 and they went up to, like I said, $4,000 for a room. That was all inclusive. That included everything. That included their medication management. That included bathing and assisting with dressing. They could be transferred. They could have certain skills helped and assisted with hospice coming in, or home health care, or medical assistance by a doctor. But we didn't provide transportation, or whatever it is. I've called a few assisted livings and talked to several co-workers up in Pueblo area, and some people charge $500 per 30 minutes for an additional service. So if mom has to take medication four times a day, and it takes that nurse up to 30 minutes to give her medication, you've just tapped on $2,000 just to give her medication based on their base price. The senior living complex, like for example, Primrose, they start out as an independent living center. This is a really great facility, and it actually has independent homes. People actually are just leasing, but they have the ability to decide they want to go to the dining room, they can go to activities, they can be part of that community, and they're paying for that amenity, and that's all they want to pay for. But let's say that person's starting to age, they need assisted living care now. Okay, so you just truck your stuff over to the other part of the building, and now you're in the assisted living, and their assisted living starts out at $3,800. But they have a standard level of care that starts out at $3,800. So for Primrose, they're charging $525 per service. And that, again, is based on what you need. So if you need bathing, or if you need any other assistance, you need medication management, they're tacking on. So that can get really expensive. And so it's based, again, on your level of care, and they have six levels of care. And so that's why an assisted living can get up to $10,000 a month. So you hope to find something that's all-inclusive. Jean, is the Cheese Factory going to be all-inclusive?
Pardon me?
Is the Village going to be all-inclusive?
Yes.
Okay, good.
With a lot of
little stuff.
Anyway, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So communities like this truly are a great choice, because you have the socialization, you have everything right there. You have a choice to go to a meal and not. You can stay in your apartment and maybe fix something for yourself. If you're not a big dinner eater and you just want to make some soup and a sandwich, you can do that. So sometimes people really don't realize it, but you know, if you were to research, you'll hear a lot of comments of people saying, gee, I never realized life could be so fun and easy. I don't know why in the hell I was staying home alone. How stupid. So when you talk to these people, once they've made the jump to detach from the personality of wanting to stay with their stuff at home, that stuff is just going to go in boxes anyway. It's better to have that good quality of life. So Primrose was kind enough, and I have some copies if you want it up here. You're not going to be able to, probably without magnifying glass, see on the handout, but I have copies up here. And what they have done, if you can get your little magnifying glasses, what she's done is, this is how she really convinces people how to get people into her facility. Because when you really add up the cost of living at home, you will be shocked that it is more sometimes than a community. And so she's basically asked people to sit down and list their mortgage, their meals, their maintenance for lawn or snow removal and housekeeping and da-da-da-da-da, garbage and insurance and all the things that people overlook when they're living at home, how expensive it really is, but people really don't realize it. So this is a good tool to maybe use. And then there's rehabilitation services, let's say like the Trinidadian Nursing Home. Sometimes people can go from hospitalization to a rehabilitation center and be there only 30 days. Medicare will pay for 30 days and they can still get rehab. Let's say, for instance, if they break a hip and their goal is to get back home, they can come back home. But sometimes Medicare and the doctor will get them to go to a rehabilitation services. So I would be ahead and call Belmont Lodge in Canyon City. And again, this is what they charge per day, and this is what it's going to cost per month to be in there if you do not have insurance. But again, they accept Medicaid and Medicare, and they do accept most insurances. So that's good. And again, they have to register nurses, doctor visits, PTO, therapists, and social workers that specialize in rehabilitation. Versus assisted livings may not. Some assisted livings do have a nurse on hand. They have doctor visits sometimes, but people still have to go out and go find their own doctor. They still have to go to their own appointment, and they still have to privately take care of their own medical personal needs. Versus rehab centers, I had a patient who actually ended up getting very sick and ended up in a rehab center in Denver. But it's always the goal is to get that person back home. Okay, so that's an option. So what does community look like to you? And where do you want your loved one to be? And it's going to be different for all of us. That looks really nice. Looks nice in my house. Huh?
Where is Primrose?
It's in Pueblo. It's up north on Outlook Boulevard, right off of Eagle Ridge.
Okay.
It's a very nice facility. A lot of people don't want to end up in a long-term care unit, just sitting in front of a TV, unattended, in a wheelchair, and having no clue what the heck's going on. None of us really want to be there. I know it. I've seen it. I've been in there too many times. It's too depressing, to be honest with you. My first job out of college was in nursing homes in Denver, and I did therapy for people. And this was way back in the day where, you know, you weren't required to have certain skills and licenses to do therapy, as Karen would remember. A PTA was just a PTA, and boy, I had an exercise degree, and they just let me start doing therapy on these elder people, and it was so depressing. The first time I walked in when my patient died, it was enough for me to go, oh, I better look for something else because I can't come to work depressed every day. Because it was so sad. Things have changed. I do have to admit, I've worked in the Trinidad in nursing home lately, working for the vets home here. There's just a lot of changes, and long-term care is a good place to retire. This isn't the best picture, but it proves the point, doesn't it? So, the cost of nursing homes. This is Trinidad Inn's prices, $6,975 a month, okay? Medicare should pay for that. Again, they do accept Medicaid, insurance, private pay. They do have nurses on staff, of course. The doctors will come over. They do have a really good therapy program that does specialize in rehabilitation, and they do have a locked unit for Alzheimer's patients. And the veterans home, our very own veterans home, now, their price will vary from $4,800 to $8,000 a month. They accept just veterans, spouses, and Gold Star parents. Gold Star parents are parents of the wounded warriors that have passed on. So they always have nurses and doctor visits and therapists, and of course the hospital is attached, and they do accept Medicaid, Medicare insurance, and private. But prices are related to service-connected disability. And so that's why you see the range of prices there, and they also do have a watch unit. So end-of-life choices and some directives. I understand that Cindy here is, because she's from hospice, and Cindy is going to do your presentation next month, probably on palliative care and hospice situations and probably end-of-life choices. I'm not going to go into this besides just telling you these are things that if you have not already done so, you need to start taking care of this stuff. And that includes everyone in this room. I'm not talking about your parents. I'm talking about yourself. Our local hospice, Agatha Hirsto and Mount Rose, can come into a home. If a person does choose to want to stay home and die in their home, they will come in and you can go ahead and call them for those services. I have a copy of a living will up here. I have copies of the five wishes, and I have copies of the most form. And I do, if you do want copies of a medical durable power of attorney, I do have that. Does everybody understand the difference between a POA and an MPOA? Does anybody have any questions about that? No? Okay. They have to be a different person, I've heard. Is that correct? From my training, I've learned it should be a different person. You don't want the same person in both of those positions. Get your will notarized and speak to your family doctor and lawyer about some of these choices. And, you know, it can occur at any time. When I was diagnosed with cancer, I did my will and I got everything all situated because, well, I didn't know if I was going to make it or not, and I made it, praise God, but I got everything in order. And anybody and everybody in here should do so as well, because we never know when it's going to be, right?
What is the five wishes? What is that?
The five wishes is actually a form that allows people to write down what their wishes are for death. It can be simple things like, I want to be sure that my favorite music is playing. I want to make sure that you rub me with my special lotion and you have my favorite booty socks on. I want to be able to have this in my bedroom. I want to be able to know that my loved ones are around me. I don't want this. I don't want that. Just special things like that. So I'll hold this just really quick. Wish one is the person I want to make health decisions care for me when I can't make them for myself. So this talks a little bit about your MPOA. Wish two, my wish for the kind of medical treatment I want or don't want, and it gives you choices. If you want to have, I was just doing it on my will. The nutrition, the life form, the
tubes?
Yeah, fed tube, whatever. What is it like? The supplemental food, the nutrition. You know what I'm talking about, Cindy. I just lost my thought.
Tube feeding.
Yes, tube feeding. But there's another name for it. Artificial.
Oh.
Artificial nutrition. Wish three, my wish for how comfortable I want to be. Wish four, my wish for how I want people to treat me. And wish five, my wish for what I want my loved ones to know. So it's a really fun, and I have lots of copies, so feel free to come together. I'm going to tell you a story, and I listed some emotions here because, you know, if we have a life that's been well lived, then there's going to be love, and there's going to be respect, and there's going to be understanding and caring and compassion, and we're going to be tolerant of our loved ones as they're going through this very, very hard process. I was visiting with somebody who, their mother is starting to go through this change, and they're having a really, really hard time. And of course, any child would. The siblings have just kind of bowed out, just don't want to deal with it, don't want to deal with her. Been divorced from the first husband, you know, 20, 30, 40 years, whatever it's been. And he's having a hard time trying to figure out what to do by himself. And I said, you really need to sit down with her and have that conversation with her, what she wants, and whether or not she really does have dementia. So I think he's in the beginning stages of having to go to that doctor and diagnose. And he says, well, I'm not going to tolerate this certain kind of behavior, and I'm not going to tolerate that. And I'm like, whoa, like, you're way off, buddy. And I'm like, you can't quite treat them like that. They still have the right to life. They still have the right to make their own choices. Had a client yesterday whose son was like, I'm just pulling my hair out because I don't know what to do with him, and he really needs to be in the veterans home. I said, does he want to stay in his home? Yes, and he has a right to choose that. And until you go to court and prove him incompetent, he can die in that chair, and if you find him gone in that chair, then that's how you're going to find him. If he falls and lays on the floor for 22 hours, that's how you'll find him, because it's his choice. So it's a very fine line for people on trying to force a parent to do something versus having the respect and the dignity to let them do what they need to do, how they want to do it. And that's very, very hard. Very, very hard. Resources and references. I told you about the Senior Blue Book. The National Institute on Aging is a wonderful resource. Got some of my statistics from the action plan I was telling you about. Colorado Over 50 is just a really fun webpage. I looked it up, and it's just really wacky stuff, just fun things. Not necessarily appropriate for Senior Answers, so I found senioranswers.org and American Society on Aging. I also, if you're interested, there's something called agingwithdignity.org, and that has some of these forums on it. Again, that's agingwithdignity.org. They have the five wishes online, and you physically can fill out the five wishes online. You also can fill out a living will online from coloradolaw.net.
Now, okay. I was able to get the form up at Pueblo at the Scott Office Supply, the full legal form for the living will. And it's the official Bradford form. But you can get Bradford forms up there.
Yes, you can. I actually saw that when I was Googling it.
Yeah.
And let's see, caringinfo.org. Caringinfo.org, I believe, is a good caretaker site. And you can also, for those caretakers in here, all you have to do is Google caretaker help for elders, and you will have a slew of caretaker support sites to help you. And I highly recommend that you really use that information, because when I was a caretaker for my parents and when they were aging and dying, it's stressful. It's very stressful. And you are sandwiched between, you know, their generation, your generation, and maybe your kids' generation, and you're having all these mixed emotions and feelings and what's going on and who do I help and who do I listen to and who really knows what to do, and there's just a lot of sandwich in there. So caretaker, just Google caretakers. There's a lot of things out there. And I just want to thank the staff at all of these agencies that helped me with some of my stats. Does anybody have any questions?
Does one start creating a list of stuff they have? I was looking through my house the other day, and I've got a lot of antiques and things like that. I would like to be placed somewhere that they would be of some use. You know, how does one start making up a list of things and, you know, what they want to do with them?
Okay, because, John, to be honest, because I haven't been in your house, I'm going to assume that it's nice and neat and clean, right? And you know where this stuff is?
Right, which is why I want the cleaning service.
Okay, so that's the first place to start, is get that cleaning service in there to sort out all the junk and the trash. A lot of seniors, and Karen and I were talking about this the other day, and she's having this problem. Can I share your story?
Yeah.
When I was telling Karen about this class yesterday at her senior fitness, she's having to move her brother into her mother's house to take care of her mother because her mother's refusing to leave the house. But her mom has been a hoarder all of her life, and they can't move in, and they're going to have to sleep on the couch because mom hasn't cleaned the bedrooms in years and years and years, right?
Pretty
so, John, start with the small steps, and the small step is get your house clean and separate what's valuable and not valuable.
Well, I am giving stuff away now.
Then just go to your house and take it and separate it. I mean, physically separate it.
Does somebody want the roll top desk, or is it going to do the most?
You could advertise. You could advertise probably before I die, estate sale, and people probably would answer me. Do you have children? Do you have children that want this stuff? Do you have children?
No.
No. Okay.
How I've got are a you? Brother How? And sister that don't care.
Yeah.
So it's mine.
Yeah, it's yours. Yeah, I'm single.
How do you convince them to let go of anything?
Prioritizing and continually having that conversation with those words I use about their dignity and their respect, and say and get to understanding, to have that adult conversation with them, and try to rationalize the best you can with saying, like we were talking yesterday, Mom, he has to move in here and he has to stay someplace. So come on, you and I are going to go start cleaning out that guest room. And she's going to go, oh, I want to do this. She'll have a little fit.
Yeah.
And you just calmly grab her hands and say, Mom, you can do this. Come on, let's just do a little bit of today. And she may not know it before an hour's gone by and you guys have accomplished a lot. You can try. Anybody have any other suggestions?
We use boxes.
Yes, that's what I told her. I said,
donate.
Yes.
Keep.
Yeah.
Be quite
yeah. We talked about that. I told her, I said, if she doesn't want to throw stuff away, I was telling Karen, then have a trash box and have a keep box. And then just put, so she knows you haven't thrown it away, put all the, don't need it right now. Okay, Mom, we don't need it right now. We're going to put it in the basement. And you just put all that. You know it's trash. She doesn't know. I mean, when my grandma died and we cleaned out her utility room, she had 6 bags of plastic containers. Mm-hmm. And you cannot change the Depression generation. They are going to hold on to everything. Everything. Mm-hmm. You know?
Someone made a suggestion to me to take a picture of it. And that way they can look at the picture and they don't have to have the big item anymore. And then they can still have a memory of it.
Well, she's nearly blind.
That doesn't help.
No.
Your idea, John, is good. A list. Just start to list the things that are valuable, things that you want to donate. Talk to agencies. Talk to foundations. We had this house we were looking at buying just for a rental, and the man just died immediately, unexpectedly, and he had this very, very expensive art from Santa Fe, and it was in a dome in Navajo. Kids aren't even monitoring this, and they live in New Mexico, and I'm like, are you guys even caring that this guy has $7,000 million worth of art in his house? And you could tell, I don't know what famous artist it was, but sculptures and paintings and everything, and you just really, I think, need to make a list, right? And figure out what's valuable and what's not. And toss it. Because nobody really cares. That sounds really bad, but they don't. Because it's just stuff, because when we die, it's not going to go with us.
Got a lot of dumpsters there in Walsenburg that happens with.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yeah. Any other questions? Do you understand everything? Did that help you kind of understand the transition that's coming and going? And some of it's not fun. Thank you guys for coming. I understand there's goodies in the back, so let's all just network and have goodies. Thank you for making the cookies, Mitzi. And I do have my equipment in the back if you have any questions. And I do have these forms if you guys want to come up and take them.